10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Been privileged. I actually do have a song. Yeah, I might do that. I don't know. We'll see what happens. Humley's a good friend of mine. Bruce from church camp. Any others from camp? Appreciate you. Appreciate all that you've done. And I know many family members, church family members. Cody, been a long time. Well, good to see you. It's Bird. Jonathan, good to see you. I think he's here somewhere. Run off somewhere. There he goes. Family, church family. We went to church, Havana First Baptist Church together, served together, known each other for a long time. Good to be here. Those that have Stan's coming and his wife, they're going to come to our church and do a revival in November. So we're excited about that. So, folks, we've got connections. I'm glad to be here tonight. You glad to be in the Lord's house? Amen. It is Sunday night. And most people are at home, either watching the news or watching TV, getting all depressed, but we're in God's house tonight, amen? We're going to have a good time. It's going to be a good week. I want to tell you that I'm a nobody, amen? Brother Kaiser, I don't mind not being a professional, amen? Because you trained me, you gave me a license, amen? That's all right. But I'm a nobody that'll tell anybody about somebody that can save everybody, amen? That's Jesus Christ, the Savior, amen? That's what we're here to talk about. We're talking about the grace of God. I was told that we've got a theme for this week. It's catching fire. And if I don't do a good job, guess what? I'm not going to be here tomorrow. That's pretty exciting for you guys. But I hope that I'm going to bring you God's word that he's laid on my heart. And if you have your Bible, I'm going to ask you to turn your Bibles to Luke chapter 12. Luke chapter 12. We're going to use several different scripture passages, but this is the one we're going to start with. In Luke chapter 12, verse 49. If you want to catch fire, you know, we can talk about fire. Fire is something that you take, you know, out in California, it's destroying things. But though some farmers know it and some that keep the forest know, sometimes you got to burn some things to clean out some things. So fire purifies. We know that we can take gold and silver, we pour it into a melting pot, heat that furnace up, and we can burn it, get all the impurities out of it. So fire doesn't purify. Fire brings warmth, it brings heat. I want to tell you that God calls us to be a person on fire. A person on fire. In fact, I want to ask you, if you have your Bibles open to Luke chapter 12, verse 49. Luke chapter 12, verse 49. If you're there, say amen.
Amen.
If you would, please stand for the reading of God's word to honor him in his house. And it is his house. It belongs to him. It's been given to him and dedicated to him by you. So we're going to stand together. If we're able to stand, unable to stand, remain seated and honor God in your heart. For the Lord, he understands. The words of Jesus Christ written in red in the Gospel of Luke chapter 12, verse 49. Jesus said, I came to send fire on the earth, and how I wish it were already kindled. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord God, for what you do, what you have done, and what you will do. God, you are greater than anyone in this room, anyone on this earth. You've done more for us than we could ever imagine. And God, we come to you this evening in the first night of revival, asking you, Lord God, to rekindle our fire. Father, we have, through being complacent and compromising, we've let the fire dwindle down in our life. We're all guilty, Lord God. There may be some in this room that are on fire. Lord God, you know that. You brought them to that place of strength, of faith, that their heart is burning with love for you. But God, some of us here tonight, we are so far from the fire. God, we ask you to do something for us that we cannot do for ourselves. And God, we ask you as a group, asking and pleading that Christ will be lifted up and glorified in our minds, our lives, and our hearts. And we ask this in the name of Jesus. And the people said, amen. Amen. May be seated. Jesus makes a very bold statement. After doing some great teaching, he wants to tell us that there's a fire that needs to already have been kindled. As the church that I pastor is in the same circumstances as the church that I pastored before, and the same circumstances as the church that I attended before, and the same circumstances in your church, there are some people on fire, and some people are not. And the things in life that take away our fire are usually money, relationships, and being hurt. Amen? We let all those things get in the way of the fire we're supposed to have for Jesus Christ, but he's supposed to cause us to overcome those things. Faith and the Holy Spirit of God living inside of us should give us a courage that we can face the hardest times of our life, knowing that Jesus will never leave us or forsake us. Jesus said, I wish that it had already been kindled. but I've come to set a fire. I'm going to divide a house, he said, a mother and a father, a husband and a wife, because you've got to stand up for me and the truth.
That's right.
And not compromise. And I'm going to tell you, church, the problem ain't with the world compromising. It's already lost. Amen?
That's right. That's right.
It's the church compromises.
Uh-huh.
Folks, it starts with the pastor and the deacons. Come on, amen?
That's right.
If you got a leadership that compromises, pastors' wives, deacons' wives, Sunday school teachers' wives, if you compromise, how is Jesus Christ going to be glorified? He said he came to bring a fire. Well, let's back up and see what he's talking about. So let's back up, if we could, to verse 22. And if you're there, say amen. Luke chapter 12, verse 22. If you're there, say amen.
Amen.
If you're not there, say hold up. All right, we're all there. Amen. All right, verse 22. He said to his disciples, and the disciple is a follower of Jesus Christ who's decided to set aside all of his ways and means of living and say, I want to follow Jesus. Maybe you're a disciple. If you're a disciple, say amen.
Amen.
Then he said to his disciples, so he's talking also to you. Therefore, I say to you, do not worry about your life. Now, that's totally contrary. I got a job I got to be in the morning. Amen. Come on, Jesus. You meant that for them crazy 12 that followed you all around Jerusalem and all the Middle East there and all those that went out after you, but you don't mean it for me. I got to still go to work and make boxes tomorrow. Therefore, I say to you, are your disciples say
amen?
He says to you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat, nor about the body, what you will put on. And probably some folks, every Sunday morning, you get down to that altar call time and you start thinking about what? Where I'm going to go eat. Amen? Come on, I mean, tell the truth. Don't lie to nobody. Pastor knows. He knows because he looks out there and people out there licking their chops. Going, I'm ready for some chicken. All right, we had potluck today. That's what you ought to do every once in a while. So you stay in church. Might ought to have it during church so people pay attention. Amen? Come on.
Amen.
Therefore, I say, do not worry about your life, what you will eat, nor about the body, what you will put on. You know, when the altar call time comes, you don't need to be worried about going somewhere to get something to eat. You know, the old South over there, beautiful place, got good old style food. That's where I met my wife. But it has nothing to do with the altar calls. The invitation. Well, Pastor, you preach way too long. Y'all better settle in, amen? Preach it way too long after 12 o'clock. Nobody gets saved after 12 o'clock. That's what they teach you. If you really believe people get saved, say amen.
Amen.
Is it true? People get saved? Say it again. Amen.
Right.
They get saved in church. And sometimes they're gripping on that pew at 12:05, 12:10, 12:15, and the Lord's moving. If he's rambling, move on, preacher. Come on. But if he's telling the gospel truth, somebody may get saved. You won't go home and eat a cheeseburger. Church, there's a problem. It's with us. Amen. I don't mind staying till 1 o'clock. I don't mind tonight staying till 9 o'clock.
Amen.
I'm going to get warmed up by 9:30. Come on, here we go. The Bible says, Jesus said, life is more than food and the body is more than clothing. I remember the first sermon I ever preached, after I got my license. Every stitch of clothing I had on was a gift given to me. The shoes, the socks, the shirt, the tie, everything was a gift given to me. I can tell you my whole story, and you look up here and you think, well, here's this preacher from another church and got this made-up history that you have in the back of your mind. You don't know me. You don't know my story, and I can tell you what I am. I'm a sinner saved by the grace of God. Amen. I'm a walking, living, breathing testimony of God can change your life.
Amen.
I had the privilege of several times speaking at high schools, and here recently I got to speak at Darnell High School. Near the football field, they wouldn't let us on the football field, and I gave the story about my father. I gave the story about my brothers, and I gave my story. And I think everybody was looking in shock, and I may shock you tonight, but let me tell you something. My father was a drug dealer and an alcoholic. My older brother's been in prison. A younger brother overdosed on methamphetamines. I was a drug addict, and that's why I came to Russellville, Arkansas. But God changed my life, amen? And he called me to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Regardless of what happens in my life, I praise the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I know you can be saved, and I know you can be changed because it happened to me.
Yes, yes.
My life is more than what I eat and what I do. And I'm going to tell you what, friends, I'm a huge, huge Razorback fan, but God showed me that Arkansas ain't greater than Alabama. But Jesus is greater than sin. It's just football, folks. Cowboy fans, I don't want to hurt your feelings, But let it go. Amen. Let it go. It's just things. Verse 24, can everybody say amen?
Amen.
Consider the ravens. Neither sow nor reap. There's neither have a storehouse or barn, and God feeds them. Of how much more value are you than the birds? Those of you got precious children, little babies around, you know, they're precious, aren't they? You just want to hold them. They're just sweet. I'm afraid I'll break them, so I don't like touching little babies. I like other kids that I play with. That's why I love church camp. You do stupid stuff and jump around and roll around. The kids think it's hilarious and tell them about Jesus. You're precious to God. Don't forget that. I don't care if you're 60, 70, 80, 90, you feel like your life doesn't have any value anymore. Your best times are past you. They are not past you. If you're living and breathing, Jesus has a plan for you.
Amen.
Don't you ever quit on this. Don't you ever walk away. Don't you ever say the church don't love me. You just keep coming and loving the church. Amen. Change the heart of God's people. Show us how to live. Show us how to walk. Show us how to do it. We need more mentors, and we're just losing them day by day. Our senior saints are passing on, and the people of faith are no longer as strong as they used to be. They're no longer as determined as they used to be. We have questions, and we don't have answers. You have the answers. Show us how to live, senior saints. Show us how to follow God. And we'll apologize when you're a little bit grumpy. Amen. We'll accept you, okay? And we'll apologize when sometimes we take it for granted. Verse 25, there's amen.
Amen.
Which of you by worrying can add one cubit to his stature? Well, I'm assuming we think a lot, amen. I can make things a whole lot better if I just stress out over it. No, you won't. Believe God. You pick out a problem. I don't know your problems. I don't know what's going on in your life, and I guarantee you there are problems in this room, amen.
Amen.
There's family members, brothers, sisters, children, grandchildren. They're out of the will of God. They're lost as a goose. They're dying, and they're going to a place called hell. And it concerns you every night when you lay down and go to sleep. But I'm going to tell you something. Jesus Christ is still the answer. Amen.
Amen.
He's still the answer. Don't worry. Let God do it for you. Verse 26. If you then are not able to do the least, why are you anxious for the rest? Well, I'm anxious for the rest because I feel like I ought to be able to change something. I can't change anything, and I hate being powerless. But Jesus calls us to be powerless, so he fills us with his power. We need faith, amen? Yeah. Consider the lilies of the field, he says. How they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I say to you, even Solomon, all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. What God has created is so gorgeous and so beautiful and wonderful, and today is here and tomorrow dies. But you don't. Oh, that body dies, but you're eternal. Either eternal separate or eternal in heaven. My goodness, you're so much more beautiful than anything else God has created. 29 says, do not seek what you should eat or what you should drink or have an anxious mind. For all of these things the nations of the world seek after, and your Father knows you need these things. What does the world tell you? You open up and turn on the television, you go out anywhere, open up a magazine, newspaper, the world says, get more, doesn't it? Get more. Oh, and I'm getting older now. My time's coming. I'm getting closer. I can see 50 on the horizon. Ooh, I know y'all too. How can he be 50? I know. I'm close. Close. When I get there, here's what I want to do. I want to stop making boxes. Have a nice home and sit on a hill with a sunset and not worry about anything else in life. Does that happen?
No.
You sure?
Yeah.
It ought to. Amen. But it doesn't happen that way. We continue to worry things. I've been planning about retiring. I've been going through my retirement account, how many years I've got to have and what I can do. And, you know, the world says you got to have this and you got to have more. And I found a house. And I thought, well, this is what we're going to get to this big old house by a creek. And one problem. I ain't got no money. Oh, man, why don't they give them things away free? The Bible says in verse 31, if you dare say amen.
Amen.
Seek first the kingdom of God. But seek the kingdom of God. All these things shall be added unto you. And if you believe that, I don't care if you live in a shack. Whoo, you're going to be blessed. Amen.
Amen.
More so than that person living on a mansion on the hill that's worried about how he's going to lose his money and how the truth's going to come out and how he ripped somebody off to get that. Peace of mind, woo, and the presence of God in your life. There's two things you've got to have.
Yes.
You've got to have. You can have all the money in the world, never have the peace of God. Verse 32 says, do not fear, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. The kingdom of heaven. Oh, my goodness, church, we have forgotten We have forgotten to have someone tell me, you know, we kind of need something new in church. We need something different. We need to do things a little bit differently. We're doing the same old things and the same old things. We need to do things a little bit different. I don't mind. You change whatever you want to. But if you're not excited about the kingdom of God being saved, I don't care what you change. You ain't ever going to be happy.
That's right. Come on.
The kingdom of God is within you.
Amen. Woo!
Within you. When you walk out this door, you're no longer, I'm no longer a Christian. I'm in the world. No, you're still a Christian in the world, and Jesus is with you in this building and outside of this building.
That's right.
And he'll never leave you.
Come on.
Well, I'm afraid of standing up and showing people I'm a Christian. Friend, don't be afraid. We've all been there. We've all been a little bit nervous about our faith. Do not fear the world. God is with you. He said, verse 33, sell what you have and give alms. Provide yourselves money bags which do not grow old, a treasure in the heavens that does not fail, where no thief approaches, no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. You spend your time gaining things. Gaining things. And that's been my job. I'm trying to put money back, trying to spend money. Got kids in college, got kids spending money. That's my money that I'm trying to retire on. My kid, what do you do? Come on now, amen, old folks, come on. Yeah, we know. Preach on, brother. What do? It costs money to live, amen. The older we get, it seems like the less we have. I've got a brother that loves me, and I love him. His wife's in the nursing home, 87 years old, worked all his life. All the money he's had to spend to keep his wife healthy in the nursing home. He said, all of our money, all of our life is gone. Home, cars, all those things. We can't have. We got to cash them in to pay for things. And it gets disappointing, but you know what? We need to learn the great lesson now. Amen. Those things are fleeting. You need Jesus. That will never change. You're going to need him from the day you're born to the day you die in eternity. You're going to need Jesus. You can have all the things in the world in that moment, in that last breath, in that last hour. If you don't have God, you've got nothing. Church, do you have Jesus? Say amen.
Amen.
Then your treasure is in heaven. And Jesus said, that's the truth. I want to teach you. That's what I want to show you. That the fire that makes you different is that you have a passion for God that doesn't matter what your possessions or your station in life is. You've got God in your life. You're unashamed to tell others that you're a believer. You don't care what comes in your life. And when the deepest, darkest tragedies pour into your life, you know that Jesus said, he's never going to leave me. And the world can't say that. They don't know what it feels like to have God on their side. They're so lost they don't even understand what it means to be lost. In church, we get together and we come together and we wonder what we can do next that could be different. What event we might have to bring folks in. Listen, friends, we don't have to have an event. We got Jesus. Amen. They got hell and the world and all the possessions. You're not going to out-entertain the world. But you're going to preach the gospel and the truth of Jesus Christ, and souls will be changed, and there will be a testimony that God can do anything.
Yes.
And then they have to choose. If you think the United States of America is going to become a Christian nation with a church on every corner and 100% attendance, you are fooling yourself. We live in a world that is upside down and backwards.
Yes.
Jesus said, I came to start a fire. The truth. You turn in your Bibles, we'll stay in the Gospel of Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24. If you like to open and say amen. Somebody said, well, we got one. Thank you, Brother Kaiser. I appreciate that. If you like to open and say, oh, that's all right. Amen. Good to have you here. I'm glad you're here. Yes, I scared you when I said that's the opening. We got about four openings before we get to the sermon. How's that? Luke chapter 24. And if you don't say amen, I'll repeat it again. Luke chapter 24. Say amen if you're there.
Amen.
Oh, praise God for you. Luke chapter 24, verse 13. We talk about one kind of fire. We talk about having a fire for God, to wait for him, to be patient for him, to love him, to set aside all the things of the world. Verse 13 of Luke chapter 24. Now behold, two of the disciples, this is after the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Some had seen him at the graveside. There's an event that goes on. Now behold, two of them were traveling that same day to a village called Emmaus, which is west of Jerusalem, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they talked together of all the things which had happened. So let's just kind of piece it together for just a moment. Their Savior, their King, their hero had been killed and crucified by the government. Pontius Pilate, the Roman government, betrayed by the Sanhedrin and the Pharisees. Jesus Christ, even by Ananias was, Caiaphas was crucified, betrayed and crucified by the Roman government. This Savior, this King that they leaned on and called on and listened to is now dead. But there's a word going around that he might not quite be dead. Verse 15. So it was while they were conversed and reasoned that Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were restrained so that they did not know him. And he said to them, what kind of conversation is this that you have with one another and you walk and are sad? Now, the story there is quite devastating, if you would think about it for just a moment. If you had a hero that you thought was going to rescue you, whether you were in the middle of a battle that we call war, maybe your sergeant or someone was there. We just did some studies. I've been doing some studies on the Medal of Honor. Been preaching several sermons at the church on the Congressional Medal of Honor. Men and women, servicemen that have earned those awards as the greatest acts of selflessness ever. They're presented sometimes posthumously after they are dead, after they passed away, what they had done to save and rescue people. You imagine having the person you thought was going to save you and rescue you has been betrayed and killed and lays in a grave. You thought this person was going to pull you out of whatever it is that you're going through in your life, whatever's happening. These men knew that this guy was going to be their king, their savior. He was going to call them away and reestablish their kingdom of Israel. And he's dead. Jesus shows up. He asks him, why are you sad? And I ask you that same question with a very different answer probably coming from you. Why are you, Christian, why are you sad? Why are through the week that you feel like that you can't handle the pressure, you can't handle the stress, you've got things in your life that are just overburdening you, and you just can't figure out an answer and have peace? Why are you sad? Let's move on. Verse 18, then one of those whose name was Cleopas answered and said to him, are you the only stranger in Jerusalem? Have you not known the things which happened there these days? And he said to them, what things? So they said to him, the things concerning Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty indeed, and word before God and all the people. And how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and crucified. But we were hoping that it was he who was going to redeem Israel. Indeed, besides all this, today is the third day since these things have happened. Yes, and certain women of our company who arrived at the tomb early astonished us when they did not find his body. They came saying that they had also seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. And certain of those who were with us went to the tomb and they found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. Then he, that being Jesus, said to them, O foolish ones, slow of heart to believe, and all that the prophets have spoken, ought not the Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded them in all the scriptures and things concerning himself. Listen, folks, I've taken two seminary classes. Yes, I'm a preacher with just two seminary classes. I made A in one of them, all right? Brother Kaiser taught. Well, Brother Kaiser put it on. Brother Jonathan Whitlock taught. Mary was in class with me. I took the other one. I had to drop out because I was a preacher. But could you imagine sitting with Jesus and him expounding the scriptures? All the questions that you have them, amen? All the doubts and fears that you have going into church and some of the studies that you've done and the things that are going on in this world, the questions about when's the world going to end? When's Jesus coming back? Sitting with Jesus and him having all the answers. I'd like to be in that Bible study, amen? Let's move on. Verse 28, you there, say amen. Then they drew near to the village where they were going, and he indicated that he would have gone further. But they constrained him, saying, abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent. And he went in to stay with them. Now it came to pass, as he sat at the table with them, he took bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they knew him. And he vanished from their sight. Now I want you to read verse 32 slowly, carefully. I'm going to read it out loud and read it to yourself. They said to one another, did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us on the road and while he opened the scriptures to us? Folks, I've been part of a lot of groups that have done some really exciting things. I've been in some cowboy ministry. I'm not a cowboy. Okay. I won't wear a hat or boots, but I've been to some cowboy ministry. It's kind of cool. We've had youth pastors. I've been with church camp. I've taken trips to India and seen some amazing things that I'll never be able to explain. But here's what I'll tell you. The only reason someone got saved is because the Word of God was preached.
Amen.
Or some. But it was the Word of God. Does not your heart burn within you when you hear the Word of God? The truth spoken, life-changing. You don't have to have a teacher. The Holy Spirit will teach you if you'll open up His Word. It will convict you of your sin and cause you to want to change. Church, does your heart burn with the Word of God? God is on your side. Turn with me to Revelation chapter 1. Revelation chapter 1. The one thing I ask when a preacher comes to church and he's going to preach in my church where I'm pastor is do not ever, ever, ever preach out of the book of Revelation. So, if you would, please turn to Revelation chapter 1. Revelation chapter 1. Pastor, trust me. Amen. I am not going to explain to you Revelation chapter 9, 13. Okay? I'm going to leave those alone for you. You can figure that out at home. Your pastor will have Bible studies and help you understand that. But in Revelation chapter 1, verse 9, if you're there, say amen. If you need me to wait just a minute, say hold up. All right, I love that. I love that. We're all there. Revelation 1, verse 9. I do hear a page turning, so somebody didn't tell the truth. Amen. Revelation chapter 1, verse 9. I, John, we know this is the gospel writer, John, the brother of James. I, John, both your brother and companion in the tribulation and kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ, was on the island that is called Patmos for the word of God, the testimony of Jesus Christ. This man had been placed in some secluded environment of prison colony for those that were rebellious to the country and spreading blasphemous lies, but he was talking the truth about Jesus Christ. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a loud voice as of a trumpet saying, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last. And what you see, write in a book and send it to the seven churches which are in Asia, to Ephesus, Smyrna, to Pergamos, Thyatira, to Sardis, to Philadelphia, and Laodicea. Then I turned to see the voice that spoke with me. And having turned, I saw seven golden lampstands. In the midst of the seven lampstands was one like the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the feet and girded about the chest with a golden band. His head and his hair were like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes like a flame of fire. His feet were like fine brass, as if refined in a furnace, and his voice is the sound of many waters. He had in his right hand seven stars. Out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was like the sun shining in its strength. Oh, praise God. It's Jesus. Amen. You imagine, if you could today, walk up into the presence of Jesus Christ and look Him in the eyes. His eyes are like a flaming fire, convicting your very soul. Where do you stand? There's no way you can lie your way through this conversation where you can pretend everything's all right. You're standing there in front of God Himself, and He's looking at you with eyes of flaming fire. Is the truth in you? Friend, that's a scary place to be. Unless there's grace. Oh, amen. Thank God for grace. Because I'm a sinner. I sin every day, whether it's neglect, omission, or commission, something I've said or done that I should not do. Say, brother, you need to straighten that up. No, sisters and brother, you need to look in your soul. Amen.
Amen.
You tell me, what would it be like if you were John looking in the eyes of Jesus Christ? Eyes like flaming fire. The words of his mouth like a sword, because it's the truth, and it cuts right to the soul. Oh, friend, the only place I can go is to my knees. Oh, my God, forgive me, for I'm a man of unclean lips, for I'm a soul that has sinned against you. God, change me, for only in you is there life. And church, we're looking for a fire. The fire is the Word of God, the life-changing truth that can convict a sin and change a soul.
Amen.
Oh, praise God, my sins can be washed as white as snow by the blood of Jesus Christ. Turn with me, let's move on just a little bit to Revelation chapter 20. Amen. Told you, brother, you could trust me, I wouldn't go to Revelation chapter 9. Chapter 20, we go from the beginning to almost the end. Revelation chapter 20, verse 7. How'd you like second of them so far? Pretty good, amen? I'm teasing with you. I won't keep you till 9 or 10. God's word is good. I believe that the problem with the church is that we do need a fire, but we need to quit talking about it and do it. You don't need to buy anything else, church. You really don't. I know we have properties, we all do. We have debts, we have bills to pay, electricity, items, church camps, Bible schools, and we spend a lot of money. It doesn't cost very much to have a Bible. It doesn't cost anything to walk up and hand it to somebody. When's the last time you did that? You just walked up and handed somebody a Bible. We used to call it a drive-by. You throw tracks in somebody's yard. Jesus loves you. Here you go. I'm getting nervous too. I drive through McDonald's or a restaurant like that with a drive-thru and I hand them a card with a scripture on it. I'm so nervous. Why are we nervous? We got the gospel truth. Not just the gospel truth. The soul-saving, life-changing word of God. And we're scared to give it out because somebody might get offended or laugh at us. There's another fire. Revelation chapter 20, verse 7, you're there, say amen. And when 1,000 years have expired, you talk to your pastor about the 1,000-year reign of Christ, whether you're premillennial, postmillennial, mid-trib, all those things. All right, those are just words right now. Go to your pastor, he'll explain it to you. You probably know, many good Bible scholars know exactly how you believe. Now, when 1,000 years have expired, Satan will be released from his prison. He will go out and deceive the nations which are in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, whose number is as the sand of the sea. There's no doubt in my mind, heart, and spirit, we're closer than we've ever been. You don't have to be wise or smart to know that. They went up, the breath of the earth, and surrounded the camp of the saints and the beloved city, and fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. The devil. I don't even like saying the name. I don't like looking at the name. I don't like hearing the word demons. I don't like hearing the word devil. I don't like hearing the word Satan. Because I'm a coward. To God, I don't mean nothing. Devil, demons, Satan don't mean nothing to God. He's got all power. The devil who deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone where the beast, the false prophet are. And they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. Here's what I want. And I want you to forgive me first before I tell you. Here's what I want. On that day, I want to be there. I want to lean down and whisper in his ear. It's about time you got what you deserved. I'm tired of you hurting my people. I'm tired of you hurting my friends. All the pain you've ever cost us, it's now gone and forever, and you'll never see the glory of God again.
Right.
Say, brother, that's a little arrogant. Oh, my Jesus did it all. I didn't do a thing. And I can't do anything. Then I saw a great white throne. And him who sat on it, from whose face the earth and heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works by the things which were written in the books. The sea gave up the dead who were in it, and death and Hades delivered up the dead which were in them, and they were judged, each one according to his works. I'll tell you, friend, you don't want to be judged according to your works. You want to be judged according to the blood of Jesus Christ that covers.